It's gonna be so bad. Okay. You wanna be on top?
Hey y'all, this is Top Model Universe 1, aka Miss Fleet 2019 on Reddit. Don't ask. And in this video, I'll be going down and ripping and running and dissecting and slish-sloshing the ANTM Iceberg meme thing that I made about a week ago on r/ANTM. So someone on Reddit basically asked about an iceberg, and I've seen a lot of videos about iceberg memes. And basically how an iceberg tier works is pretty much whatever's in the beginning or at the top, typically the sky, is stuff that's usually very accessible or pretty much well known by pretty much everybody, particularly in this case, casual viewers of Top Model would know about it. Then as you get down the iceberg, you start to go through more obscure things, stuff that is more controversial, unsettling, or stuff that just isn't as well known. In the case of the ANTM iceberg I made, this was kind of half just like thrown together. It was kind of just like a joke. And like, some people were confused by things. There were some things that were kind of taken seriously or taken literally when they weren't meant to be. It's kind of an amalgamation of things that I've heard over the years. I've been watching Top Model pretty much since Cycle 4 aired when I was like 6, and I was watching with my mama. I've been immersed in the fandom of itself probably since I was like 10, so I know quite a bit of things that I've heard over the years. And Iceberg is basically a mixture of truths, speculation, myths, rumors, and just all out just fake bullshit that I just threw in there just for fun. So I'm going to dissect each of it, basically give a tidbit about each of it, because, you know, some people may not be knowledgeable about all these things, unless you're like a super ANTM fanatic, and even then you still might not know some of these things.
It's probably going to be a long one, so you ready, Kathleen?
No!
So most people know this. This really much isn't news. Anjali was the original crowned winner of Cycle 17 All-Stars, despite having not the best trajectory nor track record, but she was crowned the winner in Greece. And the episode pretty much has this weird abrupt ending after the runway. It seems like she's like, I don't know, like she's like hungover or something, and she's like tired. And then it goes to commercial, we come back, and the judges are completely in a different judging room. They're in LA. If you didn't pick up on this, that set is actually the Cycle 18 set. It's just, you know, switched around a bit. And they announced that Anjali has been disqualified for reasons that the show found out afterward. And Lisa is crowned for no good goddamn reason. And so we find out afterward that Anjali was apparently disqualified for being an escort. This is actual fact. I really heavily disagree with Anjali winning this season, but I really disagree with how they handled this. It was really fucked up. Anjali pretty much said they knew she was an escort when they cast her. Anjali was pretty much fucked over, and I hate it for her because she deserved better. Let's start with good old Whitney. You could make cases for, like, I don't know, 3 different girls who should have won this season over her. I'll even accept Dominique.
Brazilia.
I've met no one that thinks this was the right choice. The girls on the season didn't agree, Paulina didn't agree, the fans didn't agree. A monumental season needed a monumental plus size winner in their minds, no matter how pushed or forced that outcome would be. And that's how a girl with 5 first callouts, no bottom twos, one of the highest callout averages ever, and 3 challenge wins lost to someone with 1 first callout and 4 bottom twos. Though in Whitney's defense, I will say her portfolio was not as terrible as some like to credit her with. Which leads me to Scandalicia. So Salacious is believed to have been controversially pre-select for a few reasons. 1, Tyra knew her from her T-Zone camp as a teenager, which Tyra tried to ever so innocently shrug off in her audition. But then on top of that, Salacious appeared on the Tyra show before Cycle 9 twice. And then most controversially, she had prior experience before competing, specifically appearing in a Wendy's commercial in 2006. Gossip sites were abuzz with claims of a fixed win for Salacious at the time because the show's contract specifically stated that you couldn't be in a national advertising campaign within 5 years of auditioning. This was a basic eligibility requirement. If I recall, the show came out like way later and tried to excuse this as not a modeling campaign, but I honestly believe they just bended the rules for her. Credit where it's due for Salacious. Her walk was severe. One of the best, I think, of the show. And she did well, you know, here and there. But there's no denying, other girls' flaws were magnified that season, while Salacious were downplayed. Jenna was robbed. This theory isn't provable, but I honestly do believe that Whitney and Salacious were the winners they had in mind from the jump, no matter what, especially Whitney. This theory lost legs quickly, but it's in reference to the fact that in some cycles, the runner-up is first in the intro. It started with Shannon in cycle 1, but then it came back with Joni in cycle 6, then Melrose, then Natasha, then Chantal, and then Anya. So when cycle 11 rolled around, a lot of people thought that the runner-up was going to be Lauren Bree, but her complete lack of a personality broke the trend. It's just an interesting Easter egg that they did this 5 times in a row. It's not really that deep. So this isn't just specific to Top Model, but most reality shows in general. If there's a contestant that you've not heard a word from in like 6 episodes, and then all of a sudden they get a confessional about how their pet rabbit's poop pellet spelled out model one day, and it was a sign from God that they should win or some shit like that, then you know they're going home that week. It's usually, you know, the case for girls who go home prior to going overseas, and it spans across all seasons, trust me. You'll definitely catch these on like a binge watch or something. I could honestly do a whole video on this, but all reality show TV seasons are pretty much meant to be the story of one person's journey to victory. So more than typically on Top Model, the winners have what I like to call a Cinderella narrative or rags to riches story. You'll see the winner have some type of overcoming adversity story. Most of the time, you can honestly tell who it is by following this trend. The show is essentially selling you a fairy tale that a modeling contract will change your life forever and you'll never struggle again. You can go from a waitress to a supermodel, a babysitter to a supermodel, living in a trailer park to a supermodel, etc., 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 etc. So this was just a trend that started in cycle 3 that every third cycle a black girl would win. Eva won cycle 3, Danielle won cycle 6, Salacious won cycle 9, and Tiana won cycle 12. This trend ended in cycle 14 when Crystal won, and then Anne won cycle 15, and last time I checked, Anne's not black, so, you know, the theory pretty much ended, and it was just a nice little coincidental Easter egg. Also, weirdly enough, every time a black girl won every 3 cycles, they went to Asia. So that's really strange. Well, until Tiana, never mind. So there was sort of this theory that most of the time, if a girl came in and thought that she was the prettiest girl in school, or if they thought that, you know, she was just way too pageant, she would get her hair cut most of the time for drama purposes. You see this in examples like Cassandra and Jada. I think this is more just coincidental, and those girls tend to have just had faces that suited short hair or, you know, needing to be edged out, because both of those examples, they looked better after their makeovers. And I specifically asked
Mia Farrow in Rosemary's Baby.
Yeah, probably.
Now, this is just a small piece of an overarching point, but it's been revealed by Nigel that he feels like not all the best pictures were chosen by the girls, obviously, because there was this thing where they would shoot a girl during their shoot and they would then show the computer screen of what some of their outtakes were, and typically some of those would be either really bad or they would be sometimes somewhat decent. With Kelly, she comically kind of had a bad portfolio and most of her pictures were kind of misses a lot. But the issue, and many people pointed this out as early as 2006, I remember this, a lot of the pictures on Kelly's screens were way better than what she showed at panel. And I've seen some people on the Reddit claim that,
oh, they're not that much better.
But you cannot fucking sit up here and tell me that this is any better than this. You cannot fucking tell me that this is more viable than this. It doesn't make sense. There was no reason to use this picture over this. Maybe the reason why they didn't choose this picture was because they didn't want to take the time to edit this into a group shot where maybe everybody else looked better. I don't know, but it just seemed so counterproductive, and it almost seemed as they were trying to break Kelly. And they did, where she sat in front of a mirror and bawled her eyes out thinking that she was ugly. It just didn't, it just was a really, really fucked up thing for them to do. Especially because they made Kelly look as though she, feel as though she looked so much worse in her pictures than she really did. And it just was, for me, irresponsible, and it really cost her her self-esteem. And it just, it's so sad to see her crying in front of a mirror thinking that she's ugly and there's something wrong with her facially when Kelly's beautiful. Isabella had epilepsy. How fucking irresponsible is it that the first challenge they have to do is a runway where there are bright flashing cameras? This, I'm sorry, I looking back on this, and there's a lot of problematic moments from Top Model that you can look back and go, what the hell were they thinking? They put this girl in a position where she could have had a seizure at a fashion show on stage. I don't know how deep her epilepsy was. If I'm not mistaken, I have to look it up, but I believe she mentioned on the show that she could go Grand Mall. So this, yeah, this was really irresponsible. The next photo shoot was a photo shoot with the neon lights, so that could have been the reason why they eliminated her, and they just chose a picture where she was, you know, levitating a ball so that they could, you know, have an excuse to get rid of her first. And maybe their point in casting her was to go, oh, we're so inclusive, we have a model with, you know, a disability that, you know, she has epilepsy and we still cast her. It just, it was easily read through, and I felt kind of bad for her. Absolutely. So if you watch Brittany on set for this photo shoot, she was doing a lot of crazy stuff. She had the shoes in her mouth, like she was doing all kinds of crazy poses and everything, and she looked great because Brittany's a great natural model. You get to panel and you see this. I know you fucking lied. So they clearly did this as a way to put Brittany in the bottom two to create the drama that was surrounding around her outburst at Alex. Now, was Brittany completely in the wrong for going out and yelling at Alex during that Ford thing, especially at a client's job? Absolutely, it was completely immature, bratish, and unprofessional. I mean, this screenshot tells you everything you need to know. It's almost cartoonish how much of a brat she was being. But at the same time, at least be fair. You rigged her to have this picture. There's no way, as the day is long and Natasha is Russian, that you cannot tell me that this was her best picture in that whole role. And it was clearly a reason to put her in the bottom two with Michaela and gear up that she could possibly have been eliminated for her blunder when it just didn't make sense. So Janice asserted during her time where she was fiercely feuding with Tyra and basically was yelling at a wall because Tyra refused to comment on Janice. Janice asserted, she had a video where she famously claimed that CoverGirl was the one that chose the winner, not the judges. Now, I am not going to say that Janice is completely wrong here, because I actually kind of believe this to partially be true. It's a show where you have a company giving someone a $100,000 contract. I really don't think that this company wants to spend $100,000 on someone that they don't want to win. So I think that the person that wins the season typically is someone who CoverGirl wants to work with. So I don't think that Janice is completely wrong, and I venture to say that she's mostly right here, but her reasoning for saying it was kind of just take away the show's credibility. Okay, here we go. So this one is pretty clear and evidenced by the fact that their 17th winner was dethroned because of her past experience in sex work. It's very, very unfortunate because I believe that Tyra created this show as a way to change the vision of beauty. There are women that sometimes have to go down the line of sex work. And in the past, maybe like 5 to 10 years, there's been a lot more respect given to women who do, you know, sex work willingly, particularly things like OnlyFans, and I think that's a good thing. There have been times on the show where sex work has been very much so ridiculed,
The biggest example I can think about besides Angelique is the Sindel's audition during Cycle 7, when she kind of a little absent-headedly compared modeling to stripping. And it was a moment to educate her, not necessarily to demean her. And that's basically what Tyra and the judges did, and I didn't like that.
I think she'd be happy stripping.
Like Jezebel.
Because it's the same as modeling.
So during All-Stars, Brie received a haircut as a makeover and had a very tough time with it, to the point where she told a producer she wanted to quit and was, quote, at rage. The rumor here is that part of the real reason Brie was upset was because she had a L'Oreal contract, specifically one with Garnier Fructis, so her haircut could potentially jeopardize it. The show and Brie mostly painted it as just an issue with her confidence. Granola Gate 05. Brie goes to see, so we all know how this goes. Brie goes to see that her granola bars have been opened and some are missing. So she suspects it was Nicole. Brie then avenges her precious kidnapped granola bars and pours out Nicole's Red Bulls in a vengeful retaliation worthy of a Braveheart sequel. Kim gets herself involved in Brie's business. Nicole and Kim get upset. It gets brought up at panel. They fight backstage. You know the deal. Now, Nicole vehemently denied that she was the true granola bar grabber, and Brie didn't believe her. The culprit was never officially determined, but fans speculated it may have been Lisa at first, who jokingly claimed it was her in an exit interview and got cut the week prior. Some suspected Jayla, who was basically wallpaper edit-wise by that point, so no one would have noticed, or maybe Brie just ate them and forgot. The conclusion most have determined was that it was production who stole the granola bars in an attempt to start drama overseas and build tension amongst the girls for drama. Now, Lisa and Jayla have both come out pointing the finger at production. So this theory does have legs, and I genuinely believe it. Brie would eventually apologize to Nicole when she determined that it indeed wasn't Nicole. With her brattish antics previously in the cycle aside, I have to completely commend how Nicole handled this. With the competition's high stress, they knew how to make Brie break, and Brie took the bait. So when Laura won Cycle 19, this was more just, honestly, this was kind of just bitter Leela fans trying to, you know, take their dose of copium and try to find some way to deal with the fact that Laura beat Leela. And honestly, I get why they crowned Laura. I don't agree. And I think that Laura was kind of oversold sometimes, but I get why they crowned her over Leela. I'm gonna need y'all to remember that Leela fell off of the runway. I'm gonna need y'all to remember that Leela fell off of the runway. There is no way they were gonna crown her after that. So Laura was honestly, and honestly, Laura had some bang ass pictures in there sometimes. For her to have had just terrible makeover that she did, and to produce some of the great shots that she did, I don't think Laura was a bad choice. Clearly, Leela had the far more successful career, but for this show, it made sense for Laura to win. Now, her dad was on some soap opera or something back in the day, and her mom did like one or two test shots, and they made that her storyline or something. I don't know. Her parents are rich, but no, they didn't pay her off. But this was something that I heard quite a bit on the RTVG days during around the time that Laura had won. Apparently, this was just an over edit and Allison wasn't as deeply blood obsessed as they tried to paint. See what I did there? I believe her fascination with hemophilia was legitimate. She said it herself, but it was more just like typecasting and hyper-focused to make her seem creepier. You see her painting a nosebleed from Tyra in the season, which is wild, but according to Allison, it was a thing, but it wasn't that deep. Lisa, the replacement all-star that loves to run her mouth, claims Allison allegedly has a cult following with satanic imagery, which, I mean, I don't even think you need Allison's denial on that. So this is more just like an observation because come the fuck on. So this is something Alicia claimed on Oliver's chat, that the show sort of groomed her to win. but I don't know if I believe that she was pre-select. Alicia was having Angelique Journey, who was the previous winner, and pre-selects can change during a cycle as they see progressions, edits, and burnouts. And I think Alicia was an option since it was always going to be a Brit that won, in my opinion. I arguably believe they were hoping for Alicia. Then the gears shifted to Sophie after a bit, and then Alicia's quit pretty much confirmed a Sophie victory. So Cycle 23 featured an openly Republican contestant right after 2016, where political tensions mounted in this country after Cheeto Jesus claimed power. She wasn't even a huge Trumper and doesn't support him anymore, but they needed that typecast. So she got eliminated during the week where Queens from Drag Race come on and the theme was Pride, and it was particularly bullshit because her shot that week was pretty solid. She left that early when Shanice made it to top four for no reason. And so she was clearly being used as a prop to give the finger to Trump, which, good, but not at the expense of this girl who really should have been top six minimum. This point is sort of disputed. Mr. J, during his chats, his very empty chats he used to do, he claimed that it is not true that Ford wanted Anne to win. Though, honestly, I wouldn't be shocked if they did. The final three of Cycle 3, they were remarkably short. Probably the shortest final three besides 13. And Anne kind of ticked all the boxes physically for what you would see in a model. In fact, as the entire Cycle 3 cast, I would venture to say that the most classically beautiful or usual choice for a model at that time would probably have been Anne, hands down. But Anne famously, of course, had, you know, several sizable missteps in her photographic journey. So Anne making the final four was kind of like, you know, you're getting to stay this long with all of these troubles, but then girls like Nicole go home after Tyra forgets that she's there for 1 week for no reason. That was clearly probably just editing, but I digress. I believe it. I honestly believe that they probably preferred Anne, but I would say that it would make sense that it wasn't the reason she stayed. It's just, it was sort of kind of hilarious every week to see Anne come back to set and Jay just kind of just like put his head in his hands and go, why is this girl still here? And having him to tell her week after week after week how disappointed he is in her, it kind of became just like a gag in a game. But I mean, we got to see her not hug Eva, so that was worth it, I guess. This is a pretty well-known fact. During the Bollywood shoots, the girls had to pose with a numerous amount of extras, and the intention was to stand out. As you can see, the girls were posed in the center, so they were all successful in that endeavor. What the hell? So Jayla is weirdly posed to the left of the screen while everyone else is in the center, making standing out a challenge. According to Jayla in her chat with Oliver recently, she was told by Nigel's wife offset to stay out of the way of the extras, thus resulting in this photo. And then at judging, Tyra tells Jayla that she should have commanded the shot anyways. Jayla gave Nigel's wife a death glare, who was just off camera, and then gave one to Nigel, and then Jayla was sent home. So of course Jayla was definitely going to go home that week, but you could have found a far less blatantly rigged way to clip her. I mean, it's not like he didn't have options. So a user from Reddit ripped info from posts on the Television Without Pity forums, which is no longer in existence, from around 2004 about the behind-the-scenes secrets about Cycle 3. And according to the post, which seems to have reliable information, Eva was actually the one who concocted the plan and talked Anne into actually mutilating Cassie's precious brownies. The show edited it to make it seem as though it was more Anne's idea, especially with the eventual Cassie versus Anne showdown at dinner
and Eva was just a bystander, which would make sense considering Eva was the eventual winner and they didn't want her coming off looking the worst. They should have checked their respeto at the door. This one I'm very skeptical about, but it's been thrown around for years and years. So Whitney came into America's Next Top Model with a clear narrative in her head regarding being plus size, but it's not really all that different from what the other Whitney or most plus size girls in general did in their auditions. Difference being, photos leaked of Whitney prior to being on the show where she was thinner, and the rumor here was that Whitney gained weight to be on as a plus size girl and win. But more than that, some think that she was told that she would win if she gained the weight. I've heard rumors that they at least promised her that she would make it overseas if she, you know, was on the show. As you can see, a noticeable difference between her being so cool, calm, and collected during her first bottom two with Marvita and then becoming far more nervous and even emotional when she had her three bottoms in Italy. Whitney talks at length in a blog post about her weight journey, how she was told she was too big even here at 16, where she, you know, looks rather thin, and how her weight fluctuated before and after winning the show. Even after her win, she faced difficulty fitting clothes where she was deemed too big or too small even as a plus size model. So it's an interesting read that definitely makes me sympathize with her experience as a plus size model. She's currently a vegan and seems very happy with her weight, which is wonderful. I honestly think that Whitney just came in there with a plan. It was their monumental 10th season. They needed a monumental 10th winner. Whitney fit the bill. So in cycle 8, there was a girl named Felicia who, as anyone with eyes could see, has a similar resemblance to Tyra. During the casting episode, she was even called Baby Tyra by the rest of the girls. Felicia had a pretty damn good portfolio up until episode 4, and she was eliminated 4th pretty unceremoniously after having one of the best potentials of pretty much the cast. Tyra was weirdly offended by the notion that Felicia looked like her, and she vehemently defended that this was not the case and that Kizzy looked more like her. So some people think that this was like a bitterness and that because she looked like her, she sent her home. I'm not going to say that this was the case, but I really wouldn't be surprised because there was no absolute reason I could give you as to why Felicia went home that episode, considering how well she had done up to that point. I love Dion a lot as a character, but modeling wise, she easily should have gone home over Felicia that episode. I know we wouldn't have gotten the t-shirt thing, and I hate that for us, but it really, Felicia going home was a complete robbery. And I make the case she's probably one of the most robbed girls of the franchise that just isn't talked about enough. This is a personal theory, but I've heard this for years. If you really follow the Cinderella narrative, Ebony's audition was almost identical to Eva's in cycle 3. Being seen as confrontational and a bitch by the other girls during casting, is basically told that they're a bitch by Tyra, and then finally broken down to tears to reveal where their insecurity comes from that makes them lash out so much. It's setting the stage for a season-long narrative, so that you can refer back to it during their victory. We all saw how that ended up for Eva, so it makes sense to believe that this was their intention for Ebony. She was perfect for CoverGirl, and we hadn't had a winner like her up to that point. You even have long-winded continuous storylines and panel where Ebony's not presenting herself well, and then Tyra literally showing her how she should stand at judging could come off as mocking, but I believe it was intended narratively, especially with her sitting in her chair to watch it in an attempt for her to improve, so that when she does stand up straight by the finale, you can credit them for making that change. But there's two problems. Ebony's enthusiasm never really picked up, so Ebony's first shot landed her in the bottom two for stiffness. She was kept for potential's sake. Had she stayed, she probably would have had an upward trajectory storyline from there, save one blip. Considering, Ebony was killing it up until her elimination. Her shots got better and better and better, until the plateau forced her to be put in the bottom and saved over Ambrielle for potential's sake. Yet another chance to improve, until she quit, causing a
very condescending and uppity speech from Tyra condemning her for being a quitter because, you know, because quitters are unattractive. But Tyra's speech seemed particularly over condescending, almost as if she had been slighted. This is because, in my view, Ebony just torched their intended storyline. Their narrative winner had just ejected in the top nine, this wasn't the first time, leaving them with minimal options. Ambrielle was never meant to win because she was just a filler character considering, you know, they almost just eliminated her. While Lisa was an incredible model, she was a dancer, so she'd never get cover girl. Bianca was a bitch, and she was never going to redeem that like Eva did. While Heather was a phenomenal photographic model, she couldn't walk away out of a cardboard box. Sarah wasn't the size they wanted her to be. And Chantal was great, but she had nothing about her storyline that was worth overcoming adversity, making her the perfect runner-up. That only leaves you with two possible directions, crowning Jenna or Salacious. Considering CoverGirl in 17 was the main prize, behold your new storyline. There's gotta be a reason they kept that footage of Ebony begging to be on the show. Possibly for a winner's montage, maybe? But once Ebony torched their narrative, why waste it? They decided to use it in the most petty and disturbing and unsettling way possible. I mean, it looks like it's something out of a fucking crime drama on TV rather than a modeling competition. So petty. So everyone knows during the Wild Boy shoot, Lisa infamously simulated a diaper to impress the Wild Boys, who were known for their crackheaded antics during the early 2000s. Lisa, modeling professional, shows them said adult diaper and proceeds to urinate in it on television to test it out. Everyone in the room is disgusted, even the Wild Boys, and if these human beings that drank horse semen think you're doing too much, then... child, the adult diaper pissing incident wasn't brought up at panel, and due to Cassandra quitting and there being an extra week, this episode featured a fake out elimination, meaning no one went home. Plus, they already bought six tickets. They couldn't put Lisa in the bottom and just shrug off the incident because it would have looked as if they were excusing this type of behavior, which wildly unprofessional at best, since the show still had some mild credibility during this era. The show probably wanted to distance themselves from Lisa as much as possible, and her chances of winning were in the negatives at that point. The very next week, the first week in London, Lisa produces a great photo, which is easily the best of the bunch, more on that later, but Lisa is given this weird-ass critique that she's arrogant all of a sudden, and then Lisa is unceremoniously eliminated. It's clear to see that Lisa's cut was in direct response to the diaper incident. Considering the sponsors and the show's reputation, she was quietly booted for some bullshit reason at panel. Lisa was phenomenal this cycle, walk and photos, but with her constant wine drinking during the cycle, and that was bad enough, this was just a piss on the cake. Similarly to Ebony, there's a theory that Tiffany was the initial pre-select of Cycle 4. First of all, when Tiffany didn't pass the psych test on Cycle 3, the show supported Tiffany to get anger management classes and return the next cycle. Tiffany would have ticked all the boxes of the Cinderella narrative, but the issue with her is that her improvement wasn't as quick as Ebony's, and she never really led the pack. If you notice, prior to Tiffany's elimination, there really isn't someone you can pinpoint as a winner up to that point. Usually you kind of have an idea for around like 3 or 4 by that point. The eventual winner, Naima, was very weirdly absent in the edit, especially for someone who was doing well in winning challenges. You could chalk this up to her just being soft-spoken to me, but I genuinely think what we saw of them was them editing after the fact that she had won, so their intended edit of hers could have been as absent as, I don't know, fucking Christina's for all we know. This led up to her very fucked up elimination, more on that later, where Tyra screamed holy hell at her. I genuinely believe this reaction was caused by the fact that, one, Tyra intended to scare Tiffany into a fake elimination to wake her up and then save her. More on that later. Two, she was upset that Tiffany hadn't been devastated by losing this competition as if it was her golden ticket to success and fame. And three, Tiffany was their intended winner choice. This was the halfway mark, and losing your pre-select winner and have them essentially give up at this point, forcing you to rework the trajectory of the season, which... I could see would have been frustrating, but if Tyra was going to lose her pre-select, she wasn't going to let her just go away quietly. Now she's made a spectacle of it. Once Tiffany leaves, you start to see Kenya, Kaylin, and especially Naima emerge editing-wise and receive developed storylines, which I truly believe is a direct result of their pre-select winner giving up halfway. During the Cycle 8 nude ice cream shoot, Cassandra was the first girl to shoot. She held ice cream in her hands for the duration of the shoot and held it for too long, giving her frostbite. She had to go to the hospital, and the rest of the girls put Vaseline on to help reduce the contact. We appreciate the commitment, Cassandra, but she would turn out a very bad shot and still go home that week. During open auditions at the Park Central Hotel in New York City for Cycle 13, an overheated car pulled up next to the line of girls waiting to audition. Panic ensued when three people screamed fire and everybody run, which caused a stampede. Those three were arrested for inciting a riot, and two injured members of the crowd got taken to the hospital. No one was killed, but the audition had to be halted for the day for them to figure out what the fuck was going on. The girls who came there to audition were given a later date to re-audition. So during the Cycle 20 finale, the eliminated contestants came back to root for one of the final three because it definitely matters what they think. Alexandra is noticeably absent after inexplicably returning to the competition. I really don't know why Gianna wasn't chosen, and going home that same week after an anxiety attack. It's been asserted that Alex never went to Bali at all with the rest of the cast and instead returned home to Florida for something health related, either with her mom or herself. Alex would do the rest of the shoots as an eliminated contestant for the fan vote to not spoil her elimination, but they were apparently either edited after the fact or she did them to fulfill her obligations and then immediately went home. Cycle 5 was filmed in the summer of 2005, and the London bombings happened on July 7th, which disrupted filming. The final runway show looked very cheap and far less organized than most Top Model runway shows, which was due to the fact that it was shot in Los Angeles due to safety concerns. If you notice, the winner reveal is in a completely different studio than the London panels. It's pretty telling that before Tyra announces Nicole as the winner, she says, "We've finally reached the end of this long journey." It's also the reason why Naima made an appearance on Cycle 6 instead of Nicole as a previous winner, because Nicole had only been declared winner for a short period. This is because the Cycle 5 runway and the finale was apparently shot around the same time as the Cycle 6's makeover episode. There was quite a bit of overlap between Cycles 5 and 6. So out of bumfuck nowhere in Amsterdam, McKee, who already had this weird edit to start with, develops this British accent that's like posh, and she's weirdly starts talking out of the side of her mouth. In her chat with Oliver, McKee says her best guess for this is that her dad is legally deaf and he never got a cochlear implant, so he doesn't have a normal dialect. Because of this, McKee always developed the accents of people that were around her kind of by accident. She's not sure how Dutch turned into British, but that's probably what happened. She even points to times where she picked up Jocelyn's accent, and I would absolutely pay hella money to hear Jocelyn's shrill Louisiana voice come out of McKee's body. This isn't a theory or a rumor, just an incredible observation. So Becky had this pre-existing condition which caused her to have fainting spells. It had been about 6 or 7 years since her last collapse, but at panel, when the guest judge tells her she should work on her presence, she immediately faints. She just immediately passes out. I mean, you can't write that shit. She really said, "Becky, bitch, I need you to just be more memorable." And her brain immediately goes, "All right, let me faint." All joking aside, it was a very, very scary moment. And the thud of her body as she hits the ground, my God, it stayed with me when I first watched this. And I was like, I was 7. It's so loud.
"You need to work on your presence. I didn't feel that you embrace."
Apparently, Rebecca could have had a serious head injury or even maybe died if her weave hadn't cushioned her fall. So I'm so glad for everyone's sake that Becky was fine, but it was just such a seamless transition, you'd think it was scripted. The crack you hear on the back of her head when she hits the ground, That sure wasn't scripted.
How many people were scared?